Hi, I'm Angie Greaves. How are you? This is Hugh Howey. Hugh, how are you?
I'm fantastic.
Hugh is a chosen one. That's what we said before we started rolling, didn't we?
I liked your version. I said lucky and you said chosen.
No. Well, he's lucky, but he's chosen to be lucky.
Thanks. I like that.
I think so. Okay. If you've been on the tubes, if you've been looking around London, or, well, London, the UK, you will have seen posters upon posters, bus sides, tube stations, with this book here, Wool. And I'm going to ask Hugh to explain how it all came about, because I could say, you did this, you did this, you did this, and you'll go, yeah, Angie, there's no point in me being here. So,
I'd like to hear your version.
No. I want to hear it from you. Start me off with writing one short story, because that's what it started off as, didn't it?
Yeah, it started with a 50-page short story that I had been thinking of for years, and it took being too busy with my novels to want to put this out. Okay, I'm just going to write a short story and get this out of my system.
And was it something that was bubbling in you for a while?
For a long time, yeah. This idea of people living underground and your only view of the world is this one screen, you know. And so I published the short story, and I went back to my novels and thought, well, you know, nothing will ever come of that. It's just something that I wanted to have written. And within months, it was outselling everything else I'd ever written. And it was without any promotion. It's like everything you're not supposed to do. You know, I did it all wrong and it all came out right.
But that's why I say you're chosen. Obviously, for some unknown reason, this one was chosen, okay? This underground city, where only people can get a vision of what's going on around them by a screen. Two instances came to mind when I thought about this underground city. You ever been to Toronto?
No.
Okay. In Toronto, there is like an underground shopping city railroad thing, because sometimes it's so cold, especially in the winter, you don't even have to come up. It's something like 27 kilometers long.
Wow. People just move underground in the winter.
You just move underground. And I also thought about Jim Carrey and the Truman Show.
Yeah.
Do you know the Truman
Show? Sure, yeah.
Because he's acting out his life to the world on screen and doesn't know it. But in reverse.
It's like the reverse, yeah.
There you go. Right. So when you put Wool together, what were you thinking? What was burning inside of you? And how long for before you put it on paper?
For about 8 years, I worked as a yacht captain, and I was sailing all over the world and driving these big multi-million dollar boats and seeing places like Cuba and South America and Central America. Now, not as the rich and famous. I was working for them, you know. Okay. I was doing their bidding. and from that, I fell in love and moved inland. And I started seeing that our view of the world was limited to really one screen, you know, whether it's your newspaper, your favorite news program, but we get everything through that filter. And if all we're told are, you know, the bad news, you know, what do we know the world? Or are we just getting someone else's version of it? And so that got in mind an idea of a civilization or a society where people only see this bad world out there, and who would be brave enough to go out and see it for themselves? And that one germ of an idea, which is where most books come from, just sprouted and led to all this.
And we see one book with the posters and the adverts, but Wool is actually a collection of books, isn't it?
Yeah, it.
And a different character tends to be catapulted in each book, so we then see the world on the screen from the eyes of a different character from each book.
Yeah, and the change of perspective is necessitated because my characters aren't immortal. Mm. So to put it mildly, you know, I've gotten some interesting feedback on people that you really come to know and love, and the story might meet their end. But it also gives you a more nuanced view, I think, of the world, and you see it from different perspectives and different genders and different classes. And I think it's a fuller story for that. But once you get a couple of stories in, the main character emerges and, mm-hmm. and really holds the reader's attention for the rest of the book.
Do you, obviously, you must have a very technical, science-y mind to put a collection of books like these together. Do you ever wonder if there is something else out there?
Sure, all the time. You know, we just had a really bizarre occurrence in Russia with, you know, and seeing how fragile, I mean, that wasn't even a very big rock, and it created a lot of damage and hurt a lot of people. And I think that gives us perspective. We think that we're in this perfect bubble, and then something like that happens, and you realize we're hurtling through space, and like, what is out there? And on a different level, with all the conspiracy and the lies that are in wool that you slowly unravel, conspiracy theorists have a lot of fun playing with, you know, the what ifs and how close is this to the truth. But as a writer, that's the unknown is the best place to explore. You know, that's my playground because I can make up the rules there.
I was just about to say, in not knowing,
right?
You can actually say, well, look, this is a blank sheet of paper. I don't know, but I'm going to let the pen and let my mind take over.
Right.
Do you ever read back sometimes and think, goodness, where did I get this from?
All the time. I think, God, did someone else write this sentence? I don't remember writing this sentence. Maybe it's because I write really early in the morning when I'm still sleepy. But I think when you're really in a creative flow, and I'm sure you're like this on air, where you'll hear back later and go, I was just pretty brilliant just then.
Did I say that?
Yeah, that sounded really good. So I'm the same way. Like And with the revision process, the end result is smarter than you are because you couldn't have written it out in one go like that. So when you read it in one go, you're like, this is more intelligent than I am. How did this happen?
It's really hard. And this is one of the things I love about book club, but one of the things I don't love. I want to just go for it, but I don't want to give everything away. So we have a short story that starts in an underworld, so to speak. But then different characters emerge, and that short story then becomes a number of stories.
Yeah.
You have obviously a very sciencey mind, and you've obviously a very, very inquisitive mind. Yeah. Was there ever a time when you thought, I've got to stop this because this actually, it's so unreal, I can't continue with this?
You mean with the story?
With the story itself.
Yeah, well, I had to have an end in mind. I had the last, once I started book two, see, this was always going to be just a short story. It wasn't until readers started emailing me and writing reviews and saying, where's the rest of this? And I thought, there is no rest of this. So I had to create the rest of the story. Books 2, 3, 4, and 5, which make this one novel, the rest of it all came from reader interaction and their demands. Yeah, from there, I really needed to have another good ending. I didn't want it to just go on forever. I think that can be frustrating for readers where, you know, how many, do I have to wait 3 years to start?
Yeah.
Because I don't want to, you know, get in one of those cycles of waiting. And I had the final scene in my mind as soon as I started writing book two. Yeah. And
really?
Yeah, and that helps me with a lot of books where I know the final scene. I know what I'm heading toward. I don't wander too much or stray too much. So, the idea was always to wrap it up and have something people could read in one go and be satisfied with.
Okay. So, Hugh, you decide to write this short story. You go via the Amazon self-publishing website, so to speak, to publish it. And then you leave it and you get on with your other novels and you get on with your life. When did it hit you that this was actually a phenomenon?
It was in October, so I published in July of 2011, and within 3 or 4 months, I was selling more copies of this than everything else. I had seven other novels.
That's very quick, actually,
yeah,
isn't
just
it?
Just a few months, yeah. And it the growth was really exponential. I could watch it, and I realized this was readers reading this short story and telling 10 other people about it, and those 10 people telling 10 people, because it went from, you know, 0 to 1,000 miles an hour just almost overnight. And immediately I dropped what I was writing and said, you know, that's when I just said, I need to, you know, they want more, I'm going to write more.